इट्स माई सेल्फ मिस रचना जैन, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इंग्लिश, गवर्नमेंट पीजी कॉलेज, राजगढ़, अलवर. टुडे इन दिस वीडियो लेक्चर आई विल डिस्क्राइब यू इन डिटेल द कैरेक्टर स्केच ऑफ सुल्तान मोहम्मद तुगलक इन द प्ले तुगलक रिटन बाय गिरीश कर्नाड. दिस इज माई थर्ड वीडियो लेक्चर ऑन दिस प्ले तुगलक. सो स्टूडेंट्स, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई टेल यू द मेन कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स ऑफ सुल्तान मोहम्मद तुगलक. हिज इंट्रोडक्शन. तुगलक एज अ ग्रेट स्कॉलर, इंटेलिजेंट एंड वाइज, ए ग्रेट विजनरी, हिज आइडियलिज्म, हिज सेंस ऑफ जस्टिस और हिज इम्पार्शियलिटी, Not a tyrant, shattering of his ideals, crafty politician, his impulsive nature, his frustration, and then in the end conclusion. First of all, I give you a brief introduction of Sultan Muhammad Tughlaq. Muhammad bin Tughlaq is the central character in the play. He dominates the play from beginning to the end. He is the most wonderful king that ever ruled India. He is a visionary, an idealist, a great scholar, as well as a crafty politician that can hold his own against heavy odds. His lofty ideals and dreams, however, are frustrated within 20 years. We witness the drama of the disintegration of a noble idealist and a shrewd politician within the short span of 20 years. Because of his noble ideas and visions, which few could understand, he has been called Mad Tughlaq. Girish Karnad in his play has shown him to be a man of opposites, the ideal and the real, the divine aspiration and the deft intrigue. As Professor M.K. Naik points out, Karnad projects the curious contradictions in the complex personality of the Sultan, who was at once a dreamer and a man of action, benevolent and cruel, devout and careless. A great scholar. Tughlaq is well versed in Greek, Persian and Arabic literature. He has read the Greeks. He recalls Socrates, who took poison so that he could give the world the drink of gods, Plato, who condemned the poets and wanted them to be turned out of the republic and wrote incomparably beautiful poetry himself. He is so much influenced by the excellence and the power of poetry himself. He is so much influenced by the excellence of the poetry of Sheikh Sadi of Persia, and he himself wants to make for himself an image of Sadi's poems. He wants his life to be a poem, a garden of roses, where even thorns may prick and quicken the sense. He is also an expert in the game of chess and tries to solve the problems which could not be solved by the greatest of the chessmen like Elul Adil and Saraki. His learning of the Quran is better than that of the Sheikh or Sayyid. He has made the prayers compulsory 5 times a day and has not levied any jizya tax on the Hindus or Kafir, as they were called. He knows that people of a number of religions are his subjects and they must all be treated impartially. Intelligent and wise. The learning and intelligence of Tughlaq are acknowledged by everyone, even by common men. Aziz, a dhobi, tells Tughlaq himself that he had never underestimated his prowess of imagination, and the whole world knows about His Majesty's wisdom. A young man in the crowd standing before the Chief Court of Justice in Delhi challenges the other man against Tughlaq's being anti-Islam. He says that Tughlaq knew Islam well. He is well versed in Quran and has made prayer compulsory 5 times a day and also the reading of Quran obligatory. He knows the tenets of the Quran and so he finds no distinction between man and man and treats Hindus and Muslims alike. His stepmother tells Barani that Tughlaq is a very intelligent boy. Barani, who is one of his advisors, has also praises for his learning and intellect and tells Muhammad, "You are a learned man, Your Majesty. You are known the world over for your knowledge of philosophy." Even his critics and opponents recognize his scholarship. Sheikh Imamuddin, who had raised the standard of revolt against the Sultan and stirred the people of Kanpur to rebel, also admits that the Sultan is a scholar of eminence. He acknowledges that God has given the Sultan power of learning, intelligence, talent, and that he is a learned man. Shihabuddin also never doubted the learning, scholarship, and wisdom of the Sultan. A great visionary. Tughlaq's scholarship makes him a visionary. After reading the scholars of the world, he feels the thrill of finding a new world, a world which he had not found in the Arabs or even the Quran. He longs to climb up to the tallest tree in the world. He wants to spread his branches up to the stars. Like Nehru, who was also a visionary, he has hopes of building a new future of India and is ready to explain what the people don't understand. But how can he explain tomorrow to those who haven't even opened their eyes to the light of today? His idealism. Tughlaq has his own ideas which he wants to translate into action. He knows about the ignorance of the people and the darkness they live in. He is fully aware of the injustice, hatred, and violence spread by the former kings of India. He is conscious of their poverty and misery and the diseases the people suffer from. He is aware of their corruption, the false religion, and also of the disunity in the state. He is idealistic to his stepmother and stands for justice, equality, honesty, and courage. To Barani, he says that he believes in love, in peace, in God. He wants every man to have prayers for 5 times a day and to read the Quran and to act upon it. Because he thinks that a prayer takes the people and leads the people nearer to God. His impartiality or sense of justice. Tughlaq longs for justice to work in his kingdom without any consideration of might or weakness, religion or creed. He wishes every moment to be born bright and light up his path towards greater justice, equality, progress, and peace. At the time when India is sharply divided between the Muslims and the infidels, his Qazi announces a judgment against the confiscation of land by the state officers. It goes in the favor of Hindu. It is disliked by the Muslims and suspected by the Hindus. He wants his people to be treated equally. He stands for them and is worried about them. He loves them and wants them to confide him their worries. He wishes to share their joys and to laugh and cry and pray with them. He works hard for the people. Not a tyrant. Tughlaq is a true democrat and not a tyrant. When he orders the shifting of his capital from Delhi to Daulatabad, he goes to his people and tells them, I beg you to realize that this is no mad whim of a tyrant. My ministers and I took this decision after careful thought and discussion. He also says, my empire is large now and embraces the south, and I need a capital which is at its heart. Delhi is too near the border, and as you know well, its peace is never free from the fear of invaders. But for me, the most important factor is that Daulatabad is a city of the Hindus, and as the capital will symbolize the bond between Muslims and Hindus, which I wish to develop and strengthen in my kingdom. Tughlaq allows the people to criticize him openly and not to be afraid of him. The people have been told that they have a right to criticize the Sultan and to voice their grievances openly. He goes to the people to talk them. Like Pandit Nehru, he wants to be with them and listen to their misery and sorrow, their pain and sufferings. Shattering of his ideals. Tughlaq's ideal of making his people prosperous and happy is also gone to bits. There is starvation and hunger throughout the country. People eat burnt strips of skin of all kinds of animals. They crowd round a butcher shop to catch the blood pouring from the slaughtered beasts and drink it. They are dying without food. They are facing drought and famine, stalking the land, and die unnoticed, unheard and unsung. There are riots for food. Barani also is sad at the shattering of Sultan's ideals. In his words, "Your Majesty, there was a time when you believed in love, in peace, in God. What has happened to those ideals? Corpses are seen in the road." So all his idealism is shattered. Justice and equality is denied by his state officers to the people. Aziz sits as a civil officer, does not allow a poor Hindu woman to go and see her dying child. He wants money for the help sought. Thieving and looting and killing are rampant in his state. Aziz and Azam and Karim are busy looting the people. So all his idealism is shattered. A crafty politician. But Tughlaq is also a crafty politician who stoops to trickery, cunning, firmness and wickedness. He commits one murder after another. He is charged with patricide and fratricide. He orders his stepmother to be dragged and stoned to death and commits matricide. To do away with the opposition, he lays a trap for Sheikh Imamuddin for becoming of his envoy for peace and gets him murdered. Again, when Shahibuddin and the Amirs of the state plan to murder him at the prayer time, he keeps his balance, catches them in his net. His soldiers kill the Amirs and he himself stabs his most trusted lieutenant, Shahabuddin. His impulsive nature. Tughlaq is impulsive by nature. He always thinks that he is right and all his actions are right too. Nobody can foretell his moods and actions and his own fate. His stepmother does not know that she will be killed. Sheikh Imamuddin does not find out the snake behind the flower, nor do the Amirs suspect that they will be butchered or killed. Even Barani, his confidant, cannot help making a mistake, and the wicked Aziz will be suitably punished. He never thought that the most treacherous Aziz will be rewarded by Tughlaq. His frustration. Tughlaq's ideals were frustrated within the short span of 20 years. As the play ends, he orders that all should return to Delhi, and thus he compounds the misery of his people. He thus realized his mistake and consequently was considered mad by the people. Mad Tughlaq. He is called Mad Tughlaq. He ordered that copper coins would be the currency of his kingdom and would have the same value as silver dinar. There was nothing wrong in it, for in China they already had paper currency. But he gave this order without making proper arrangement for the minting of new currency. So he heaps of counterfeit copper coins reached him and had to be dumped in the rose garden, which was the result of much effort and labor. In this way he brought ruin and disaster on his sultanate and made himself a laughing stock of all concerned. His spiritual anguish is well brought out by the following lines. God in heaven, please help me. Please don't let go of my hand. My skin drips with blood and I don't know how much of it is mine and how much of others. I started in your path, Lord. Why I am wandering naked in this desert now? I started in search of you. Why I am become a pig rolling in the mud? Raise me, clean me, cover me with your infinite mercy. I can only clutch to the hem of your cloak with my bloody fingers and plead. I can only beg heavy pity on me. Have pity on me. I have no one but you, and now only you. Conclusion. The play ends as he sleeps on his throne, tired and exhausted, then wakes and looks around, dazed, frightened, as if he cannot comprehend where he is. In this way, Tughlaq is the central character in the play. He dominates the play from the beginning to the end. Thank you for listening to my presentation. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you.